graphic designer with a great deal of experience, but this afternoon he's not really going to talk about his work, he's going to talk about his dad. So, Humphrey.
I think I'm stone following stone upon stone, if anyone's been to Somerset. Edward Johnson, that name again, taught Eric Gill, who taught Runnels Stone. Each in turn became masters of the 26 Roman letters. My father loathed talking about his work, but here I am, his biased son, is going to try and tell you about the man behind those letters in an effort to explain their quality, as his character and life are embedded in every line he engraved. Talking of character, you might be amused to hear what Gill himself said in an interview with Beatrice Ward. Just as personality is expressed in handwriting, character is revealed in lettering. To be able to design an outfit, one must have discipline and order in the mind. Then the thing becomes easy, and the letter, to be successful, must look easy. I suppose Reynolds and Johnson wouldn't have disagreed with that. As it is, of course, Reynolds' work speaks for itself. It's so direct. I mean, it's almost impossible to put into words exactly why the shape of the letters, such as you see here, seems so satisfying and beautiful, and dare I say it, to me, more refined and elegant than Gill's. Anyway, today I'm concentrating on his lettering, because he's a lot of other things, and doing so roughly chronologically, though Reynolds didn't have his blue period, as it were, and arrived at his original style almost overnight. Now you see him in his early 30s. Who was this man who happened to combine brain, eye and hands to such a remarkable degree? Though modest and diffident a character, he held deeply passionate convictions. Unassuming, he had an inquiring and scholarly mind and was a superb craftsman. The thing is, above all, he was an artist, with an artist's vision. Born in 1909, his father and grandfather were classics masters. He learnt to draw at an early age, encouraged and taught by his mother, who died sadly when he was 16, who had trained under Tonks at the Slade. Here we have Reynolds' signature tool, the engraving tool, known as the graver or burin, with a flourish. He loved creating patterns and making pleasing shapes. This is the cover of the first book on Reynolds, published by the Cambridge University Press in 1947. The foundation of Reynolds' lettering and designs was learnt during his 2 years as an apprentice at the printing shop of Cambridge University Press from 1930 to 32. There he learnt to see the craft of printing as an art, and for a future engraver, the importance of the printed page. He was inspired by the clarity and sharpness of metal type. These are the most formative years of his life. But what do you think led him to engraving in the first place? Well, he did his first engraving on a piece of type metal, as you see here, fudging up sorts, encouraged by the composing room overseer F.G. Nobbs and Walter Lewis, the printer at Cambridge University Press, who soon gave him a piece of boxwood. This engraving is a design, by the way, for the cover of a catalogue for a Gutenberg print centenary exhibition, which as a result of the Second World War didn't take place. Knocking about in Nobbs' cubicle were the 7 volumes of the Fleuron, a journal of typography edited by Stanley Morrison. Reynolds was bowled over by these journals and thought how lucky to have been there just at the right time. He was always saying his life was a series of lucky dips. The first volume of the Fleuron contained a learned article by Francis Mannell and Stanley Morrison on printers' flowers, which was chiefly concerned with arabesque patterns. Reynolds made traces of these. He was later to say, "Craftsmen and artists should thank God for scholars." These initials of Morrison's you see on the screen are from a device used in various printed items, commissioned originally by Brooke Crutchley, University printer at Cambridge, in 1947. Note the characteristic narrow cap N. Morrison was to have a huge influence on Reynolds and become an important patron. In fact, he was more than an influence. He was a sort of conscience. And really, for the rest of his life, Morrison was looking over his shoulder. The great thing is he introduced him to Italian Renaissance italic hand by publishing a facsimile of Arrighi's writing manual. And he also admired, in that first volume of the Phaleron, Eric Gill's new Perpetua type, decorated with Gill's engraving. The chance encounter on a train to Cambridge that led Gill inviting him to Pigott's, that's where he ended up, at the end of 1932. There, he carved his first alphabet under Gill's instruction. At the time, Gill was sculpting Prosper and Ariel for the BBC, which you see on the side here. It's a shame we can't quite see how big Ariel's balls actually were before being cut down to size at Lord Rees' command. Imagine a committee meeting to do that. However, after a stimulating fortnight of this heady atmosphere, he knew instinctively he had to escape. The important thing was Gill had given him the confidence to develop his own style. So no art school for Reynolds. This is to be his only lesson. Otherwise, he learnt the technique from Linton's manual instruction on wood engraving. If Gill was influencing his capital letters, then other people besides Morrison, like James Wardrop, were introducing Reynolds to a galaxy of Renaissance masters of the Italic hand. One of these masters was a Spanish calligrapher, Juan de Iciar. On the left, you see a page from his writing manual, Artis Subtilissima. Equal credit, by the way, should go to the engraver of this manual, Juan de Vingles, who signed his initials on the blocks, IDV. This was Reynolds's eureka moment. White line against black background, which so excited him. Meanwhile, after leaving Cambridge, he'd taken a job at a rather dim printer in Somerset. He started to engrave at nights, and within a year he got his first commissions, book plates from people like Beatrice Ward and the American calligrapher Paul Standard. By 1934, he had enough work to, as he put it, sack himself. On the right, by the way, you see one of his first commissions from Francis Memel, the Nonsuch Press, to decorate a book in 1935. The calligraphic flourishes have replaced the flowers of one of the ECR, as it were. Lowercase, by the way, the lowercase G followed by Y is always a bit of a brute, isn't it? In the word anthology. It's amazing how quickly he has mastered the engraving tool. Here's an old example from hundreds of book plates he used to engrave. This one also uses letterheading for the calligrapher and scholar James Wardrop, who wrote, amongst other things, about Arrighi, Palatino, San Vito, Caliente, and Cresci, and became Reynolds's friend and patron. As it happens, Reynolds was not a calligrapher with a pen. It was as if he needed the engraving tool to perform. He's really a sort of sculptor, I think. The graver dictated the clarity and style of his lettering. As Edward Johnson said, let our tools and materials teach us, as it were, to make beautiful shapes for us. As for handwriting, his own handwriting, Wardrop's own was superb, unlike Reynolds's, which John Carter, Will's brother, considered an undistinguished scrawl. Reynolds, in his defence, didn't like self-conscious handwriting, particularly the type, as Stanley Morrison wittily put it, that it exuded the scent of some calligraphic cosmetic. Baines Wardrop, however, at one point wrote to Reynolds that he obviously thought his writing was improving. If your powers are brought to bear on the pen, as they are habitually on the graver, heaven help us all. Yours apprehensively, James. Here's John Carter's bookplate. Interesting to note the FL ligature. Do you think Reynolds has been looking at too much type? But in general, it's already showing simplicity, directness, and authority. And while at Cambridge, Reynolds enjoyed rummaging about in second-hand bookshops, where he discovered his beloved Buick. From Buick, he learnt the craft of engraving white line for tone and shadow. Years later, in 1970, Ian Bain, the well-known expert on Thomas Buick, commissioned this bookplate. Reynolds adored waterfalls, trees in a natural wild landscape, and birds like this dipper. This block is only 3 inches wide, the dipper 1/8 of an inch. I think Buick would have been proud of it. I wonder whether this ability to draw natural forms, like a tree, with engraving tool, helped to, as it were, draw his letter form. Incidentally, I just found something that Morrison wrote to Reynolds saying, anyone can draw trees. What I think he was implying was, get on with a more difficult job of engraving letters for me. From Digging from Many Ampersand Hogs, Typophile Society in New York, 1936. He's just having fun. In the late 1930s, he's beginning to get commissions for book illustrations. The next two slides are from Rousseau's Confessions, commissioned by Francis Manuel of the Nonsuch Press in 1938. Kenneth Clark's comment that Reynolds mastered the union of the decorative and closely observed could certainly apply to this engraving, even at this earlier date. Here you see they have a happy knack of combining lettering and landscape in a pleasing, coherent design. Furthermore, one that harmonises with the type below it. Reynolds lived through his eyes, minding terribly what he looked at. Kind, too. I learnt the other day from his late sister a touching story of how, as a very small boy at a party outdoors, he captured a bee and withdrew its sting so it wouldn't hurt anyone, while at the same time not hurting the bee. Of course, little did you know that removing the sting wasn't going to do the bee any favours. He was incapable of killing anything and was always rescuing spiders from the bath. He liked insects. I remember once spending half an hour with him stock still watching the praying mantis. His patience in the stillness and inner stillness were two of the essential characteristics that shaped his work. Indeed, Reynolds was incapable of living anywhere but the countryside, and longed in particular to live in Dorset, where he had spent his childhood holidays near Bridport. The Stone family had roots in Dorset. I like to think they came from Portland and were stonemasons. That's rubbish, they didn't at all. This is the title page of a book published by the Gregory Press in 1938, commissioned by James Wardrop. The style of this engraving is not a million miles away from Juan de Ithiar, but he's already developing his own individual style, and this is not a slavish copy. Meanwhile, he had to be content with Bucklebury in Berkshire for the moment. Here's a letter heading for his first home after marrying my mother Janet in 1938. I remember this place well, though I hadn't realised he'd painted the roof to avoid it looking bright and new. I also remember him rubbing his hands at a newly planted grove of birch trees in the foreground of this engraving, which he did like this. And when we saw him doing that as a family, we knew he was in a good mood. Trees, in fact, were his passion, but not gardening. My mother must have wondered whom she had married when, after a day spent digging the border, she found on the next day Reynolds had replanted the dandelions. He loved wildness and couldn't cut anything. He preferred natural organic growth and tangled, mysterious, dark corners. Sylvia Townsend Warner describes his love of trees like this. He looks at trees with an astonishing degree of love and trust and penetration, almost as though he were exiled from being a tree himself. Wonderful. Being extremely absent-minded, he was unlikely to remember my mother's birthday, but the last minute, in the first year of his marriage, he somehow did remember it and worked through the night to engrave this. He did well like doing things at the last minute, shades of Edward Johnson. My mother had this lute made out of pearwood, as she was a soprano singer. However, when my brother, sister and I were born during the war, she gave up singing and devoted her life to Reynolds. She was very efficient and did his bills, which allowed him time to immerse himself in his work. Of course, as you can imagine, not being able to kill a flea became a conscientious objector during the war. But after much agony, he joined the RAF to make maps and models for reconnaissance operations. He worked in a Nissen hut near Henley, and he was able to secretly engrave, amongst other things, the title page, which you see here, in a series of lapidary books collected by John Sparrow and commissioned by Stanley Morrison in 1943. By the way, he was a keen rower, and apparently his nickname was Anglepoise Stone by his colleagues in Lisnard on account of his distinctive appearance while paddling down the Thames. The first of his many public commissions was this victory stamp. Talking of stamps, he hated opening letters. Pierce Pritchard, the guest at his breakfast table, observed, "When his mail came, you pick up the envelopes, turn them over, examine the stamps, peer closely at them, and put them down without opening them." After the war, alongside public commissions, he continued with book illustration, particularly for Fabers. This is the chapter heading for Apostate by Forrest Reed, 1947. In fact, we spent much of our childhood having picnics in churchyards. It was looking at one that Reynolds discovered the old rectory of Littoncini in Dorset, where we later lived. The wild garden there has become an inspiration for much of his work. Reynolds never felt the need to travel, as he'd see in a small area a thousand designs, and in the dense foliage, a mystery that, like Samuel Palmer, nourished his spiritual nature. There's another chapter heading from Apostate, witty pacing for the words. When he was a child, he'd fallen in love with trading sailing vessels, which he observed in Bridport Harbour. He would draw them, and then make models of the boats without any kit. And as a boy, and as a dreamy boy at that, making these model boats must have given him a passion for accurate detail, patience, and an ability to concentrate. It was a useful discipline for a future engraver of the alphabet. This book, page of 948, happily combines three of those passions, trading ships, water, and trees. Although probably influenced by Buick, this landscape is unmistakably Reynolds, displaying his own way of looking at nature with freshness and truth. As it is, Reynolds preferred to concentrate on the gentler aspects of nature than Buick. You won't find any dying horses in his engravings. Public commissions began to flow in the late 1940s, this one being the Christmas card for the British Council, 1948. Here is some lowercase Roman for a change, and an early delight in the possibilities that heraldic design gave him. He found he could introduce a degree of naturalism into what is essentially an emblematic subject. Note the upward stroke of the lowercase e, which he often preferred. And this wonderful cover, commissioned by Owen Morshead in 1949, I found an extensive and rather pedantic correspondence on what Reynolds should put into this design. In the end, ignored most of it, and his unerring sense of how to make it bold and simple won the day. As Brooke Crutchley said about my father, it was only necessary to give him minimal direction. His imagination, his scholarship, and his good taste did the rest. He's usually unhappy with a large size as this, but I expect to enjoy the unicorn, which he sort of had a thing about. Here's another cover design, done in 1950, for the publisher Rupert Hart Davis, for whom he also engraved his device, his logo. The titles in this series were set in perpetual type inside the flag. This fox has been closely observed and very much alive. Stanley Morrison commissioned his royal coat of arms for the order of service at the coronation of H.M. Queen Elizabeth II. It's interesting to compare the previous design, which looks weak, flat, and grey, with the vigour, strength, and richness Reynolds has achieved in this block. He signed it. Another coat of arms, commissioned by H.M. Stationery Office in 1955, looks familiar. Reynolds will be delighted to know that it's digitised well and is still being used on all government papers and on British passports, though they reversed the black lines to gold on that. I suspect its practical simplicity, directness and clarity have kept it in use. He had already engraved the clock device to head the leader page of the Times. The present version, which you see today, is a wider redrawing, copying his design. He's rather pained that they didn't get the length of the size handle right. Have a look next time he's here. Reynolds' splendid engraving for the masthead, commissioned by Morrison, was discontinued when Thompson took over the paper and removed the news from the front page. Incidentally, there's one masthead still around, that's the one for The Economist magazine. She did. This logo for a shoe shop was designed in the early 1950s, and for a while graced the high streets of Britain. In those days, you didn't get paid much for logos, but at least he was promised a pair of shoes for every year of his life, apparently. He designed another shoe shop logo, Ballet, until they decided, like Dulcis, to ditch it for an Egyptian slab serif to keep up with the times. This commission, on the other hand, probably did put some money in the bank. These notes were designed in 1963. They were eventually superseded by decimalisation, which is a shame. I was in Italy when I opened Genti magazine and found myself staring at a photograph of my miniskirted sister Phyllida. And word apparently got round that she'd been the model for a new slimline Britannia. Apparently Phyllida posed my father sitting on a chair with a broom in one hand and dustbin lid in the other. Just recently I read a newspaper article criticising the drawing rather harshly, while conceding the lettering was fine. They got a point. Drawing figures was not his strong point. He designed two typefaces, this one for Linotype, to provide display sizes to accompany Pilgrim, a type designed by Eric Gill and originally called Bunyan for use in his private press. Minerva was issued in 1955. The bold version of Minerva, perhaps the most successful part, was adapted for some years for article headings in the New Statesman. The other typeface, called Janet, after my mother, was made for his own private use at the Litoncini Press. The typeface, type founders Austin, cast the type directly from the engraved alphabet you see here, and no touching up was subsequently done. This preserves a certain vitality, but the fit of some letters isn't brilliant, and the full stop and comma are too small. He used Roman caps for the italic. Note, the italic lowercase g in the fourth line, a letter form he often preferred to the Gilish g shown as an alternative in the centre of the bottom line. Incidentally, Reynolds amassed a fine collection of Albin printing presses, all rescued from destruction. In those days, people were just chucking them out. He wrote about them, considering them beautiful in their own right, as well as a practical means of proofing his wood engraving blocks. Guess where they all are now? In Japan. As for decorated letters, he explained in a letter to Rory MacLean that he didn't often feel the need to decorate the letter itself, which would more or less degrade its form. Though there are occasions when degradation is required. That's what he said. The forms have acquired a kind of absolutism, akin, in a much simpler way, to the human form in our eyes. It is not usually necessary for the limbs of nymphs to start sprouting leaves, however richly decorated their background may be. As for his adherence to traditional letter forms, he wrote in 1963, "Of course I agree about my limitations, which are obvious. But in general, I don't feel limited as to what one may or may not do now, because I don't feel that anything that has flourished in the past has come to a full stop forever." The secret was he knew his limitations. He had a stubborn integrity to be himself, never experimenting for its own sake, but always striving to reach the very high standard he set himself. I remember being fussed when I worked in America that I wasn't keeping up the times, and he wrote back saying, if you think it's right, it'll be right. Don't look over your shoulders. He preferred working in the sitting room rather than the studio, which is really eccentric. Surrounded by books, as you see here, and on the right, a collection of Victorian bindings. He's probably listening to, on an LP, to Mahler or Ravi Shankar, or Gérard Souzet singing Forêt on the latest hi-fi equipment. Sylvia Townsend Warner describes the scene so well. He worked at a massive table matted with every variety of confusion and untidiness, graving minutely on a small block. He worked likes to work amid a number of conversations he needn't attend to. He liked to feel people within touching distance of his glass case. Of course, if he heard a bit of gossip, his ears flapping a bit, he would join in. And he would often sort of slide noiselessly off his high bench and take a book off the shelf to show one. I wonder whether there's a connection between this intimacy of his surroundings and the intimacy of his work. Reynolds had finally made it to Dorset in 1953, although apparently when he first arrived, he sat with his head in his hands, thinking he'd get no more work. Zooming in on that workbench, you see to the right his engraving tools, in the centre his sandbag on which the blocks rested, and two finished blocks, made of boxwood, of course, which has been sprinkled with French chalk to show up the white lines. Incidentally, he first sketched his ideas on the back of an envelope and then transferred them roughly onto the block using a pencil and process white. And here he is, rather sort of posed picture, in later old age, demonstrating how you manipulate the block with the left hand while pushing forward with your right hand with a tool in it. And of course it was all in reverse, so he'd used my mother's compact mirror to check progress. As a child, Reynolds was made to write with his right hand, though basically left-handed. I suppose in those days you were made to do that. So I wonder whether that skill with the graver was partly due to his being ambidextrous. Reynolds said he seemed to know precisely the angle to apply the graver. It's rather like rowing, he said. You have to put the oar in at the right angle. And one more picture of him, just to show that he painted watercolours all his life, what he called his salad paintings. They're always very green. Some of them form the basis for his engravings, and he'd paint in the afternoon, descending into this wild garden he had, with plenty of dandelions, with its spring water rushing into ponds, in a dell with enormous elm and peach trees. Unlike Gill, he never used a magnifying glass and was very short-sighted. I wonder whether short-sighted people intend to enjoy detail. There were paradoxes to his nature. He was clumsy and dithery, hopeless at mending china, and an appalling driver. He would hesitate when passing cars. But no hesitation with engraving tool. In the barns behind the house could be heard the sound of the tapping of dummy on chisel, mixed with the wailing of Duke Ellington's band. My brother and I loved it, or we played ping pong. Reynolds had begun cutting letters in stone, mostly slate, after the war. By 1956, he was commissioned to cut this huge tomb for Duff Cooper. Michael Harvey arrived to the rescue at this point as my father's first assistant and soon found himself cutting this massive work. Michael's written eloquently recently about his time with Reynolds in the recent issue of Matrix magazine. And to paraphrase Michael, Reynolds' method of working was unlike most lettering craftsmen. He would sketch out the letters by trial and error to start with, in pencil and white gouache. He used a pencil to refine the edges of letters, and slowly the design took shape. His skill was making subtle adjustments of letter width and spacing, just a thought there, a thought here, there. As Michael said, it's a way a painter works. He was essentially an artist. In fact, this image is the wrong way around, never mind. But I put it in to show his wonderful Roman nose. He's polishing the marble slab for Churchill's memorial stone, which lies on the floor of Westminster Abbey. He liked touching, by the way, the surface of things. whether stone, trees or rooks. And here is the finished job, which nearly ruined his tools. And Michael and subsequent assistants, John Andrew and Keith Ablett, cut most of the stone carving, but this one Reynolds cut himself. Incidentally, he found one line too long and was allowed to change it. In place of memorial, he carved stone. The dean in chapter placed this stone and was laughingly accused of having done it as a signature. I'm sorry I'm unable to show more of the 100 or so inscriptions he designed. I mean, you can see them all over the place. If you go to Sissinghurst, you'll see Sackville West lived here. And in fact, I'll let you into a secret. He misspelt Sackville, and no one noticed, without a K, until it was almost put up. So he had to do it again on the back. So now you know. He did a few book jackets, which were not on the whole a great success. He needed that engraving tool with which to express himself. However, I think this one is quite successful. I remember Cecil Day Lewis being rather chuffed with the title of this book, which I think he thought of long before he wrote it. By the way, Reynolds was very keen on ivy. Now, and if you want to see another one of his lettering, you go down the Mall and you'll see a slab of slate with the capital letters, very large, rather magnificent, saying Queen Mary and the dates on it below her bust. And I found a correspondence where Reynolds suggested, wouldn't it be nice to have some ivy around it? He loved ivy so much. Didn't he realise it was the one thing Queen Mary loathed was ivy? Apparently she went round the whole country ordering it to be taken off wherever she saw it. For this engraving, which appeared on the jacket for the New English Bible, he was able to use the graver. I remember him telling me how impossible it was to represent the Bible in graphic terms. I don't think the bishops were any help about this either. Talking of Bibles, and I'm just going to show you some slides of title pages. This one for a privately printed edition of E.V. Roux's translation of the New Testament, distributed by Sir Alan and Richard Lane as a Christmas present, printed at the Curwen Press. These capitals remind us of the superb ones cut by Cresci, which Reynolds considered possibly the finest ever drawn and cut in wood. Note the characteristic P that doesn't quite join up. This one, printed by Giovanni Mardesteig at the Officina Bodoni, Verona, in 1962. There's a horrible moment when this arrived in Verona, when the block split in two. But of course, made of boxwood, it's necessary to make a large piece of boxwood in several spliced together pieces. Luckily, Mardesteig had the wit to place it in his wine cellar, and it grew back together again. And an electro was quickly made. Note the heart's tongue fern-like border, a plant found in the garden at the old rectory, and he was always using plants in his garden as a basis for his designs. Here's one more title page, though you could mistake it for a book page. It's the title page of Calligraphy and Paleography, Essays Presented to Alfred Fairbank, published by Faber in 1965. It's pretty stunning, isn't it? He designed countless private press and publishers' devices, or loggers, I suppose you'd call it. But this one for his first cousin, Will Carter's Rampant Lions Press. I love the way he's ended up that squiggle with his signature at the bottom. This one, the Folio Society, commissioned 1947 by Charles Eade. The Folio Society now use it with the lines reversed, i.e. black on white, which I think is not nearly so good. Never mind. He has a device for a paper company, now defunct. And he has a whole page of publishers' devices. Hamish Hamilton at the bottom, John Murray at the top, Dents down there. The Hamish Hamilton, by the way, has been redrawn very unconvincingly. He has a splendid logo showing black lettering on white this time, just to show you could do it. Reynolds had to re-engrave the words "the Royal Institute of," the Royal Institute of, because it was originally without the word "royal," and I don't know how he managed to do this until I looked really carefully at it and noticed that "Royal Institute of" is fractionally less cat high and navigation, but you wouldn't notice it, should you? Sorry, the word "the" was missing, not "royal." No, it was "the Royal Institute of." I think it's about time we saw some more book plates. And this one is a riot of flourishes and maybe rather over the top for some tastes. But didn't Edward Johnson, it's that man again, say, if you're going to flourish, flourish! However, Reynolds soon learnt that, to quote him, one bold flourish is usually better than a large number of small twiddles. The danger is to do too much, because the eye, delighted by a small mouthful, is soon surfeited. Quite right. Here we are. A model of restraint and elegance. He used the solid background as an enclosing shape. And another one. Simple. Inevitable. I think this one, I think R was his favourite letter. And he just had, he thought, oh, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to put it on a line by itself and have fun with it. This one, for Bob Elwell, shows Reynolds' gentle sense of humour and the love of visual pun, because actually that lovely man Bob Elwell, the late Bob, told Reynolds he loved collecting things, thus the magpie. I found a letter to that Reynolds wrote to Elwell at the beginning, which he says, "I'd be grateful if you let me know the kind of thing you're after. I will then have a shot at engraving something. I like working this way because I find that the submitted sketch is usually misleading." This reveals Reynolds' innate modesty. Now, I'll have a shot at it. But it also shows a confidence that he wouldn't have to do it twice. Talking of his method, he would draw the design only roughly on the block. He allowed his graver to do the work for him, or it ran away with him, he would explain rather disarmingly. "I think it's this element of spontaneity that gives his flourishes their vitality, grace, and unselfconsciousness. Nothing is forced." And echoing Gill's words, my father said, "It should appear easy." The swirls that he uses are not there for their own sake, but because they're an integral part of the design. They owe their success to their conviction. If they ever fail, it's due to a lack of inevitability. On the whole, he allowed the letter form to dictate which letters he used to extend and flourish in a natural way, as you can see here and on the next slide. Oh, what fun he's had here, because he's linked all the flourishes to another letter. And yet it looks natural and unforced. He never minded, by the way, his many copiers. He just was flattered. Here's another one with a pun. He had a characteristic chuckle, which he no doubt would have made at the thought of the reception of this engraving. Back to some heraldic bookplates. Being a bit of a scholar and pedant, he enjoyed the detail and graphic possibilities of heraldry, and he wasn't remotely interested in its boring, snobbish aspects. And this is Prince Charles' official bookplate, engraved in 1970, which he liked so much that he asked him to do his private bookplate, which is here in all its glorious simplicity, which I much prefer. Before I end, I want to show you a set of engravings for the sayings of St. Thomas Aquinas by the Limited Editions Club in 1971. I think they are masterpieces. Note the characteristic A with the angled top. He always did it like that, unlike Gill. And the ravishing Q. Part title of the illustration for The Creation. Slightly awkward. Nude. A chapter opening for The Creation. Alpha and Omega. Just imagine that is cut into wood with an engraving tool. No hesitation. No correcting. Can't do anything about it. Off it goes. No room for error. Corpus Christi. To conclude, I'm showing an alphabet engraved for Philip Hofer at Harvard University Library in 1953. Amongst all his work, Warren McLean thought his engraving of letter forms were his greatest achievement, and that Reynolds attained the ultimate in purity of form for these shapes. Finally, from the praise of happiness of the country life, whose title page we saw at the beginning, Eric Gill famously tried to create a cell of good living in the chaos of our world. Reynolds, in his own quiet way with my mother, made a peaceful refuge in the heart of Dorset for their many friends. Here he could be free to explore the pleasures those 26 letters of the alphabet gave him. He died in 1979, aged 70. He was a totally unpretentious man who remained true to himself, his life, his character, and his work were one. Thank you.